for some reason, I sort of had a decline today, and I'm looking for my go-to. What do I do? Is there some go-to graphic, some representation, some song, some artwork, anything at all in this world that I can go to? And I realized that there isn't anything. And this is kind of shocking. And so the question is there anything that you can go to that reminds us of reality? And the answer is no. No, no, and no, and no. But this is sort of a trick answer, because actually no does remind us of reality. So, no, absolutely. That is the go-to. I realize that's the go-to phrase, is no, no. And just get comfortable with that and feel that. Says, by saying no, there isn't anything, that does remind us of reality, of pure spaciousness. So nothing reminds us of pure spaciousness. There isn't anything. And that nothing at all reminding us of reality, really, that is the reminder of what reality actually is. There's no way to represent reality. There's no way to define pure spaciousness. There's no way at all. And by focusing on this, we reach a higher ground. We can find a new stability, but it's not easy. I'm sort of going through a depression phase here, for sure. But that can we can flip that script at some point. Earlier in the day, I was feeling great, very confident, and asking God for the answer. Has any appearance ever altered you at all? Has anything ever altered you at all? And waiting for the answer and haven't gotten it yet, so maybe I'm feeling depressed about that. But the go-to response is no, there is no graphic. I was trying to think, can I make some graphic that will remind me of reality? I'm looking online, searching for some image that reminds me of what I've been talking, pointing towards, and intuiting. And I can't find anything. Never been able to. And so this is rather frightening. You think I may never find what I'm looking for? Why would I want to find something that reminds me of reality? Why not find reality? But we're in search for something that reminds us of it, represents it. We're looking for a representation, which is really just our arrogance again. Because saying that there can be a representation of it means that reality isn't reality, it's changed. Because actually there is no way to represent reality. So one way to look at all the icons and statues and sacred objects and whatever, they don't really have anything to do with reality. They don't remind us of reality really at all. They don't represent it in any way. And they don't really remind us of it either. Very sobering. They don't represent it. They don't remind us of it. So just entertaining this idea, it feels very much of a wow, heavy wow reaction. Just sort of feeling, what would it feel like? How can we accept that there's nothing that has ever been fashioned, that we've ever fashioned, no object, no appearance that reminds us of reality? And yet, that need not bother us because we can experience reality. Reality doesn't need to remind itself of reality. Reality is not needy. So we can experience it. So if we can experience it, why do we need to seek for something that reminds us of reality? Obviously, that's part of our arrogance. believe that this depressed feeling is the realization of this, that nothing we've ever done has in any way touched upon the nature of reality and representing it in any way, and even pointing to it. You can't point to reality. It's not possible. You can't point to what is omnipresent. It's not possible. And so we feel like we're losers. Like, we can't do it. Well, there's no contest, so there doesn't need to be a winner. So if there's no need for a winner, there's no need for a loser. So we really can't win, and we can't lose, neither. Now, I was feeling like giving up this evening and just not taping, but I said, no, you know, let's just give it a try anyway. Something just floated in the dark here, just through the dark. It's almost midnight, and something just in the air just came floating down like it was some sort of little ball of strands of fibrous, light fibrous white material. That's really strange. Like something that, like dryer, like coming lint from the dryer or something, you know, just decided to float down through here. That reminds us as much of reality as some statue of a saint or something, really. But neither do, actually. Nothing does. And what it bothers is the lazy people, who unrepentant people, unrepentant minds that want to have some idol, you know, and by telling them no, there isn't anything, I can feel their upset, their depression over this, or disappointment. I've sort of internalized that. This is a problem coming to this world. Everybody wants you to make an idol for them. And if you don't, they become, you know, supremely depressed and frightened and despondent, because they fear that then they're going to lose and they'll be annihilated, which is delusion. They're too lazy to look into this fear, too petrified also, which is why the necessity for saints and enlightened ones, self-realized beings here, to take the edge off that petrification. Because otherwise, people just continue to look for idols. Not people, spirit, mind, keeps looking for idols. But we have to go beyond idols and realize there isn't anything that can truly remind us of reality or represent it, be close to it. Not at all. And as such, setting up an idolatrous religion is a waste of time, you know. And the idea of helping lots of people, it doesn't work that way. But paradoxically, the more of us that can accept this, the more help there will be down the road, and the more we'll be helped, literally, actually, really helped. It's just that there has to be a continual enlightenment of those who have taken the path of enlightenment, and gradually build up this kind of momentum. But certainly people will be despondent. Idolaters, which is almost everyone on this planet, which means those who have not repented of their extreme arrogance, that they certainly are desperate to find some idol which substitutes, really. They say represents, but they really want is a substitute. Something that they can fixate on and therefore keep their arrogance and keep believing that they can win a contest with God and avoid annihilation. This is what they want. They want a representation, an idol. And when you realize that there isn't any, then you kind of, you feel the despondency. I can feel it within me. I have to somehow let go of that because it's affecting me. Now, when mind gets moved off idols and starts the path, it doesn't believe that this is helpful. It thinks that this is not going to help at all. And yet it still can go down that road, and it can be helped down that road, even though initially it doesn't, it feels that this is just a waste of time, or it's just not going to ultimately succeed. Not understanding the clear teaching about that all of this is just a play of our arrogance, and how arrogance frightens, we frighten ourselves with it. It's kind of like helping somebody do something, they begrudgingly agree to do so. They say, that's not going to help me. That's not, I'll do it, but it won't help. This is their attitude of the world. But we just have to see through this. We know that it is helping. Boy, I'm really jittery tonight. The slightest sound conjures up some sort of attack or some sort of tumultuous situation. We defend against recognizing that there's nothing represents reality by confusion, chaos. By claiming that that's the problem, not that nothing can represent reality, but that our mental state is chaotic, so we're not able to fixate on what does represent it. So really the price we pay for arrogance is this fear of chaos. Or not just a fear of it, that we actually employ it from time to time, and we're aware of this dreadful defense that we have. This is the part of the price we pay, along with death and fear and all of that confusion. We just say, yes, there is a way to represent it. It's just our mind is so completely chaotic that we're not able to fixate on it. And that's the problem. But that isn't the problem. There isn't any way at all. So if we can accept this, then we don't need to use the defense of chaos anymore. We can walk past that graveyard. So this is a very heavy time. You can tell, but that's fine. I embrace that. That's par for the course. It's like playing a very difficult golf hole, and you make par. It's great. You struggle, but you still you come out and you make a nice putt and to save par, and you say, wow, that's tremendous. So we don't run away from the challenge, the difficulty of this. So, chaos is not this chasm that separates the enlightened and the unenlightened. Not at all. So, from their standpoint, they say, well, I'll never be able to make it because chaos will arise. And it will stop me. It's too difficult. There's no way. No, we're getting past it, chaos. We're recognizing the right context of what's really going on. That's a defense we're using. It's like claiming that arrogance does have effects. We just can't fixate on what they are because our mind is chaotic. This is just hiding the fact that there isn't any. There is no effect of arrogance on reality. It's non-causative. So those who claim, there's just no way I can really make it, it's not true. And by making it ourselves, there's something in us which others will recognize, and they'll say, hey, the dawn will begin for them. They're saying, this one doesn't have the fear that everyone else has. It's something, they don't seem to be afraid of chaos. It doesn't bother them the slightest bit. Wow, what's going on here? It will be a wonderment, something deep inside that like a chord that doesn't fit the song that they're trying to play, the song of defeat. It doesn't fit into that song. So in that regard, it is helpful, although they will certainly insist that there's just no way. What they're saying is they can't see a way, which is understandable. I've been bothered by this for 48 years, trying to get past this chaos, mental chaos, trying to, what is this? Why does this arise? So it's not surprising that people will say, hey, there's just no way. There's no way I can do that, and try to settle for something less. You see, it defends against the presumed annihilation, the chaos. And we think we have to win in a contest against God. And if we see everything as equal, we say, well, I can't pick out a winner. I can't pick out a representation. I can't pick out something arrogant. It's all equal. And so we might panic. And we, to protect ourselves from that, we throw up chaos, mental chaos, where we say, well, I could pick, I just can't get the mind to stop. It's all chaotic. Yeah. So it's quite, nervy to look at this chaos issue, mental chaos issue, like this. I'm certainly paying a price of strain from this, for sure. It comes with the territory. It's like the stakes are so high that even when you can see there's no trouble, you're still very jittery. It's like, let's say you're going along a road and there's this metal fencing along the road, real strong metal fencing, like to prevent you from going over a cliff. And let's say there's a wall along this road, right by that metal railing. And on this wall is a mural that's painted of a great cliff, a great chasm there. And so all the while you've been driving along this road, terrified you're going to fall into this chasm. And then you realize it's just a mural on a solid wall, and there isn't any chasm there at all. But still, you're looking at the mural and you're still jittery. Still jittery. It's sort of like that. Because we've been believing for so long there's this abyss, there's this annihilation for us, that to recognize, oh, it's just a mural, it's just a painting, it's just fake, there's no trouble at all. Wow. Residual shaking and fear. certainly to recognize chaos as just a defense like this is that we're intentionally employing to avoid recognizing that our arrogance has no effect on reality, and also we've been believing we're in a contest with God, and the winner gets all and the loser loses all, and we think that if we don't win, then we're going to lose. And seeing reality as it is, perfect, would feel like losing. So we want to be able to pick out something that is fixated in reality, something that is not in spaciousness somehow, something that's autonomous, separate from reality. And if we don't see that, we're afraid of losing. So instead of seeing that there's nothing autonomous in reality, everything is equally included in pure spaciousness, instead of seeing that, we see chaos, mental chaos, and then claiming that there is something autonomous, we can't settle on it. Everything's just flying around chaotically, and that's preventing us from recognizing what is there to see. But really, there isn't anything there to see. There isn't anything autonomous. We're just tricking ourselves, scaring ourselves. Ultimately, the confusion is meant to say, hey, it's there, we just can't find it right now. But it's time for this sort of recognition, because the world is going cuckoo at a quantum rate, which is what I was told in what I've been saying, that as we go through these 15 months up to June 21st, 2016, it's quantum. The speed of collapse of sanity on this planet is quantum, actually. It's lies are true-ism is now being pushed to just an unbelievable extent. The oppressors now in this world are claiming to be oppressed, actually. Everything's backwards, you know, upside down, backwards, and you're supposed to see this as truth. It's a defense. It's a severe defense. But when you cut through all these defenses, you run into, there goes that piece of lint again. Interesting. Or is that a insect? When you cut through it all, you get to this final defense, which is chaos. Mental chaos is the final defense that stands in the way of abiding in self-realization and truth, non-dual truth. It's the final defense. This is what I experienced in the autumn of 2000, autumn of 1978. I recognized reality, and then I felt like it was too much of a continuity issue, fear for me, and I said, well, what do I do? And this immediately this mental chaos arose, and then I said, wow, I can't stay in this. And then the spiritual path began of lessening the continuity fear, but also I saw that we then tried to search for answers that leave this chaos, this defense intact, unexamined. We try to find spiritual answers that will satisfy us, but ultimately they don't. So part of the spiritual path is recognizing all these so-called answers don't really satisfy us. So many don't satisfy us. And so now I'm back at this chaos, but now very different. Instead of panic, in a panic reaction to it, in a desperate pleas for help, now I'm like poised and saying, oh, I see why we employ this, you know. You know, you even make friends with this defense and say, okay, yeah, no problem. I understand why you're doing this, continuity fear issue. Don't want to drop the arrogance. And so if you in order to keep the arrogance, we have to believe there's a contest with God. In order to believe there's a contest with God, we have to believe there's something autonomous that attracts us, that can hold our attention. So we want something that's similar to reality, except it seems to be a symbol, something autonomous to reality, a symbol. So we want idols. And if we don't have any idols, we will see reality, actually. And if we interpret that as losing, then we'll be terrified of being annihilated. And so we will throw up this defense of mental chaos. So it's a great place to get to right here. Now the world views it with utmost fear and trepidation, that somehow you're losing interest. I'm losing interest in mental chaos as a defense. They say, well, without that defense, we're doomed. You know, you got to have that defense. So, you know, they say at all costs you have to leave that defense unexamined like this, at all costs. And so they try to have a spiritual path which keeps this area unexamined, which is why so many fail. So many fail on the spiritual path. They leave this area unexamined. I think the Bible says, he who persevereth to the end shall be saved. Must persevere to the end. Must examine this this defense, this ultimate defense, which seems to save us from losing and annihilation. But really, it's just an alternative to seeing reality, abiding in reality. It's a way to panic away from it. You know, it's a way to get away from it and then rationalize that. It's a way to reject reality and then rationalize it, and a way to keep arrogance going. So, but there's so much inherent fear in the world of examining this area. Even when you see it clearly like we are here, there's still all these jitters and fear around it. That's the tough part. That can't seem to shake that right away. It's just totally habitual here. It's just something that's accepted, that this is absolutely taboo, and you don't and even if you clarify it, you're doomed. You know, that sort of attitude. Because you won't have that defense anymore, that means you're going to lose. You won't be able to contest reality, contest God, you know. And so they think, you know, that ideas will be annihilated then. But keep in mind, we never had a contest with God. We never entered into any deal, and he struck any bargain whatsoever. Now my voice is, you know, it's gone bad this evening. I just took a nap and woke up. My voice has gone bad. I had that allergic reaction yesterday, and my voice is going like this, which was similar to when I last time I dieted. The same thing happened. It seems to when we try to get healthy, it seems like at some point our defenses we get frightened. We don't want to lose this final defense that we have, this seemingly fail-safe defense of mental chaos, where we can certainly claim that there's something there for us, but we just can't get it because it's chaotically bouncing all over the place, and we can't anticipate where it's going to be, so we can't capture it. We can never seem to capture it because it always seems to be chaotically moving, and we just, you know, it's like trying to catch a butterfly. We just don't know where it's going to go next, and we're chasing and trying, but it's all chaotic, and we just say, I can't get it. That's a defense. Reality isn't chaotic at all. There's nothing to catch like that. It's everywhere. So we don't have to be frantically pursuing anything. And of course, pursuing something in chaos is another defense, saying, oh, it's not really chaos, I've almost got it, I'm tracking it down. So we really deceive ourselves. And I've noticed it's difficult for everyone now to be looking at this, and that's perfectly understandable. But it will get better. It will get better at some point. You'll be able to ease into this for sure. I just have to show that it's possible here, but very understandable that this really is the heart of our dread right here. To be without the defense of mental chaos seems to us to be annihilation. It's funny. So we think we get to choose between annihilation and mental chaos until we finally quote unquote win, which is to imagine an autonomous reality that's autonomous to us, to God and Spirit, both, which is doesn't exist and never will. So we always have to conjure up this potential of chaos, whether it, you know, be an attack, something very tumultuous. We often act it out in a very tumultuous way, where we undergo an attack or engage in attack, you know, victimization of all the various types of warfare. Victimization is actually part of this, a very strong defense too, but mental chaos is even stronger. It's even deeper. It's even deeper than victimization. Victimization is sort of a minor way of using mental chaos, but it's possible to actually directly experience it, and that's the most severe defense we have. I experienced that in 1978, and I was like, wow. That's a shocker of all shockers. That sort of shocks you away from reality. So I tried at that time to reach reality so I could be of help to the world, but this defense prevented it. So now I'm trying again, and I'm experiencing, you know, a lot of stress, because we need it now. We can't wait again. Exponential quantum collapse of reason, sanity in this world now. It's really frustrating, and gets us angry because we feel helpless to do anything about it. The liars here, they're so adept at demagoguery and lies, and spinning people between each other, fomenting class warfare, fomenting race warfare, fomenting gender warfare, fomenting all this stuff. All they do is foment. And, you know, if you're intelligent, you realize this is all, you know, nonsense, but they're very adept at doing this. So it's very tough to explain to other people. You can see it for yourself, but to explain it to others, it's too difficult. So we have to literally have something we can turn our attention to, which is enlightenment. Very important right now. Because the fomentation, just a general uproar, is itself a defense, because that's tumultuous, isn't it? So they're trying to bring this tumultuousness in at play in here in the world, okay, as a defense against truth. As a defense against truth. Because then we say, well, we don't need truth. We have the answer here. We just can't find it. So we have to keep on searching for it here. See, it's a great, great defense. Tumultuousness. Whereas a peaceful, more peaceful society, you're able to look at your defenses more clearly and recognize them, which we have to do. Whereas if you have the world stirred up as it is now, countries against countries, religions against religions, races against race, genders against gender, you know, against this other gender, all these different things, purposefully, agitation being fomented. The world, especially the United States, what's going on is professional agitators are in charge. Their expertise is in agitation. This is a time-honored technique, a defensive technique in this world, which then supports sort of enslaving yourself to continuing on in this supposed contest with God, bodies, time, space, process, form, bodies, worlds. This is what happens in this world. So it's happening very severely now. And I just have to try to stay away from news because it's just astonishing. And the advertisements that they put up and is just absolutely messing with your mind, trying to twist things backwards in all different ways. And whatever way they can twist it, they twist it. So here we are looking at the ultimate defense. So that's way more interesting than all this fomenting of turmoil, which is acting out this defensive mental chaos in a less severe way, actually. Even like world wars and all this stuff is much less severe than directly experiencing mental chaos. That's the worst. Directly experiencing mental chaos is you feel you will never be sane, because you feel you have to find, there's something to find there, and you'll never find it. And so you feel you can never be sane. And from this, you then back off the defense, but then you accept that you can't deal with it, and you have to settle for something else. And then you basically settle for trying to find a nicely framed picture of mental delusion. You continue on trying to win this imaginary contest, is what happens. You invest in trying to win. An imaginary contest which doesn't exist with God. But then you feel, I don't feel so... I'm defending myself from this mental chaos because I believe that this body is real, and this is, you know, and I'm working on these bodies and working on this autonomy and believing in it. And then you feel somewhat protected from this defense that'll bite you if you don't keep doing this. So this is real in-depth psychology here. This is the heart of psychology, our true psychology. This is what's really going on. And the only way to get through this is to recognize the nature of reality and accept it and be very clear about it all. Pure spaciousness. Cinco de Mayo. Was that today? It was yesterday. It's today? You'd never know it. The real Mexicans don't even celebrate Cinco de Mayo in Mexico, actually. It is an American thing. If you ask the Mexicans, they hear the, hey, Cinco de Mayo. They kind of look at you like, huh? What are you going to do? Nothing. What? As far as the world goes, you can expect just jaw-dropping. I mean, you just don't even want to think about it or deal with it. Or you want to continue on with your discipline. And we believe we'll have some help where this issue of this defensiveness was brought to light. And we can all say, hey, you know what? We can do it too. It's worth our while to put our attention on this, on true depth psychology, true healing of the mind. And we're not going to go along with this reinvestment in this non-existent contest. We're just not going to go along with it. And you will start to feel more assertive. You know, lately, I've been feeling very assertive about flipping the whole script in the world, about not being able to be bullied around anymore. But this issue of this, you know, mental chaos keeps trying, you know, it's there. So I have to, you know, keep looking at it. But once that is resolved, then for sure, I'll be able to be very assertive in terms of just, you know, absolutely having leverage over any attempts to, you know, get me to reinvest in delusion. And this is what happens when you get past this, you know, this defense. But I'm not there right now. It's sort of like the tide. I'll feel very assertive and able to see, wow, I can flip the whole script here. And then I'll feel then like, wait, I'm not sure if I can do it. You know, and then you get a little worried. It goes back and forth like that. So that's to be expected with the jitters surrounding this. Again, you know, trying to discuss this with anybody, you know, they think that, wow, you got to stay away. You know, you're in super dangerous territory, radioactive territory. You don't dare be without this defense. This is what saves us from annihilation. And people say, don't worry, soon we're almost winning against God. And once we win, then we won't need to have this defense at all. We won't need to go back to reality. We'll be able to define reality the way we want to define it. And so they say, just stay away from it. And most keep doing that. And this just keeps them spinning their wheels. Look at the world. Most here are just spinning their wheels. It's obvious. Waiting for a win. You know, waiting to win. But eventually that waiting, you get tired of waiting. But the ones who are still, you know, not really on the path, they're just still waiting for a win. And they say they feel they can wait a little longer and put up with, you know, the misery of this place. So we can choose between mental chaos and reality. And reality is just that we see that there isn't any exception anywhere. So there's nothing, there's no chaos at all. It's not a question of chaos. It's a question there's no exception. Nothing's been changed. We didn't change anything. There's no exception at all to that. If we can accept that, that's it. Whereas if we don't accept that, we'll say, there is an exception, I just can't find it. And why can't I find it? Because my mind is totally chaotic, that's why. I need to somehow slow this chaos down. Once I do that, I'll be able to find it. Those are the options we have. So if you're really not ready for, you know, abiding in non-dual reality, if you're not ready for it, then you're going to back away and say, no, you know, I have no choice but to choose this chaos, and I want to stay away from that. I'm going to defend against that as much as possible. It happens. This is why I say a spiritual path has to be a lifelong commitment in terms of this is your, you realize this is it. I'm going to do it this lifetime. And it has to be like that. Otherwise, you'll reach this goal. You might go this far, and then you'll say, I've got to back away. I can't go any further. It's too rough. But there are some who, this is their final life, and this they're decided to do it, so this will help them for sure. The numbers are not large at this time in the world, but there are some who are once returners. This will help them also. So they say, "Well, I can't quite do it this life, but next life I'm going to do it." And I see that that is possible. I just don't quite have the momentum this life. So those can be helped. And then those who are, you know, not yet really into it, they can at least vaguely see, oh, okay, when I do get into it, I realize that it is possible to succeed. So everyone's helped in some way. If it's not so obvious, you know, it's not so, but yeah, okay, well, this is pretty good here. It's getting pretty, it's getting late, it's past midnight, so I have to get up early. So just to show you, you know, that what's going on, the intensity is reached, you know, crescendo as the external, this world is really becoming crackpots. I mean, the crackpots are in charge. There's no question about it. And if you have some sanity, you're saying, oh no, you know, what do I do? Holy cow, this is not good. This is not good. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.